resume in 1 Timothy, where we left off last time. Chapter 2 and verse 8. I will therefore, will there means I want, my earthly desire, that men pray every prayer. Now it's men as men. It's not the generic word for the human race. It's men. He's talking to brethren here, not sisteren. But he'll get on to the sisteren in due course. Men pray. Now it's the basic word for prayer. Our Lord said to his disciples, all men everywhere should pray and not faint. Why worry when you can pray? Old chorus says that. Sometimes we're supposed to have turned it around so it becomes, why pray when you can worry? Because after all, worry is fun and everyone's sympathetic. Lifting up holy hands, oh, come ye Pentecostals, lift up holy hands. We are body, soul, and spirit, and it's all linked together, and our body language should express how we feel. And how do we feel? We are reaching out to God, and that's expressed by lifting up holy hands. When our Lord prayed in the Gospels, you know how it is with us, somebody says, let us pray, and everybody sinks their chin into their tummy and shuts their eyes. And I wonder if they've tuned the world out. Our Lord never. What did he do? He lifted up his eyes unto heaven. There is nowhere in the scripture of which I'm aware that those who pray close their eyes. Our Lord said, watch and pray. As one of the angels said to me once, all right, you pray and I'll watch. But at least he had his eyes wide open. Now, there's very little merit in doing anything in particular, whether it's kneeling down, or as one friend of mine in ancient times who went out as a missionary did when he prayed in his own prayer meeting in his own assembly, lay on his tummy in the middle of the floor and thumped the floor with his fists and only lifted up his eyes to call down the fire of heaven on these backslidden brethren. Our posture, body language, expresses how we feel. And if we really want to reach out to God, I know no objection to doing it, but if we just want to wave to him, or to our brethren, like the Ford dealer in the advertisement, so that everybody behind him does the same, I don't see any particular merit in that. This sort of thing is mentioned a number of times in the scripture. In Nehemiah 8:6, they all prayed and lifted up their hands to God. Psalm 24:4 is the well-known Pentecostal chorus. I will lift up my hands in thy name. Hebrews 12:12 is the same sort of thing as in 1 Timothy chapter 1. If you wish to express how you feel, do it. If you want to kneel down, do it. Perhaps we should have some kneeling pads here at Ashton. Our body language, just a modern term, our body language ought to express rightly the way we feel when in the presence of God. without wrath and doubting. Now there are the three things. I hope you can hear me above the echo, incidentally. No doubt, without faith it is impossible to please God, for he that believeth, he that cometh to God, must believe that he is, and that he is the author of them that diligently seek him. No doubt, no hesitation, and no violent emotion, because that's what the word wrath means. Wrath in English means anger, but wrath in the verse here means violent emotion, not necessarily negative. In other words, we pray with the total being, but certainly with understanding also, said Paul. All right, what about the beloved sisters? In like manner also, single word in New Testament language, that women. Now we don't get into this matter of prayer. Still, we've been talking body language, and now we can talk about.
Could you switch that over here?
A clothing language. Women adorn themselves in modest apparel with godly fear and sobriety, not with braided hair, or gold or pearls or costly array, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works. Now it seems on the face of it to be rather tough on the sisters. Sometimes in one assembly where Valerie and I met, we used to say that the sisters had competitions among themselves in the matter of the hats. They had to wear hats, you know, the brethren said. They had to wear hats. They wore hats, but they made sure that they wore fashionable hats. And it seems sometimes if there were a competition running so that one could say, my hat is more fashionable than yours. And something had to be said about it in the end. To us who observed, it was quite fun. Now, what does it really mean? Obviously, there's a balance. I remember Billy Graham at the showgrounds back in 59 giving the old anecdote. They said to him, Billy, that counseling woman's got lipstick on. What do you think? And her answer was, she needs it. That was very, very widely quoted at the time and became the justification for a lot of lipstick sales, which increased greatly, I think, in the Christian community at the time. Now, there's a balance to be observed, and when it comes to ostentation and a hat competition, something's gone wrong. Now, why concentrate on the ladies? I don't know why Paul chose to do so here, but I do know that the same sort of thing is said about the men in the New Testament any number of times. The men are to be sober in our demeanor. Why concentrate on the women here? I'm not sure. I'll make some suggestions later in the book when suitable references emerge, but he doesn't. So that's all there is to it. All right, don't overdo the matter of appearance to the point where it becomes an expression of vanity. In like manner is used 6 times in the pastoral epistles. It's an unusual adverb. Usually to apply the same teaching to both men and women. And then I give the examples. Both are to pray constantly. Pray without ceasing, men and women. But as with the men, that's verse 8. About the men, I guess, they've got Apparently, in our history, we've put up with wrath and doubting a great deal more than we've put up with the hat and the lipstick. It's a matter of balance. Something is required of the women's first, modesty. The word cosmetics comes from that, so that's one up to Billy Graham. No cosmetics, unless you need it, of course. Modest demeanour, self-control, and if we had time, we could go to 1 Peter chapter 3 and find another long section on this. Peter thought much the same. Not with elaborate hairstyles, gold, jewellery, or rich clothing. In the cultural setting of Paul's day, these sorts of things were a way of showing that you were from a strata of society which was special, and these were the badges of being special, whereas most of the Christians were from other strata of society. And one of the things that Christianity did in the Roman Empire was cut across all these strata of society and bring everyone together as all one in Christ Jesus. So I think what Paul has got in mind, among other things, is that everybody behaves in a way which acknowledges that fact. We are all one in Christ Jesus. Look at Ian, he's telling everyone he can afford a Fletcher Jones suit. Well, I've got to confess, I am a bit of a snob. I never buy trousers other than Fletcher Jones. Never. I do get them at the op shop. But interestingly, people who wear Fletcher Jones trousers die the same as anyone else, and into the op shop their trousers go. Tremendous. I'd much rather pay $3 for a pair than $83, as I used to do in the days when I had a dollar to spare. All right, not with an appearance that declares I am from another stratum of society from yours. Testimony to godliness is seen in good works rather than in style. Acts chapter 9 is Dorcas, full of good works. They showed Peter and the apostles all the useful things that Dorcas had done to the other members of her society. Well, that's how godliness is shown, by good works. Not only with women, but with men. Why single out the women? Not sure. We'll read on and see if we can find out. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection. One of the first verses I ever learned in the Brethren. How our society conducts itself. Shut the women up. I soon found at St Kilda that applied to the meetings, but nothing else. Now, silence is silence. Silence and subjection is subjection. The subject person in the presence of teaching maintains silence. Now, once again, to apply this unilaterally to sisters is not balanced. It is applied in Scripture in the New Testament to the brethren as well. In the famous 1 Corinthians chapter 14, where it says, I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to be an authority over her sphere. What does that one say? I've forgotten for the minute. No, I'll keep talking while I have a look. 1 Corinthians 14 is an exhortation to be orderly in Christian meetings. keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak. But they are commanded to be under obedience, as saith also the law. And if they will learn anything, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is a shame for women to speak in the church. So there. Later on, when I read the passage in the original language, I made an interesting discovery, and that is that the word for silence, which has to do with calm and peace, and as an aside, when the Lord rebuked the wind and the waves, they settled down and there was a great calm. It's the same word. The word is applied in the passage twice to the men. If a man can't make himself understood in the church, let him be silent. If he's speaking, and another man has a revelation from God, that's interesting, let the man who is speaking make way for the man who has the revelation from God. Does that ever happen? Oh, I've seen it happen at the Smithson conferences, but that's quite a long time ago. I don't think it had happened very much in the present time. Summing up, the word is applied twice as much to men as it is to women. And one of the historical fallacies in the Brethren down the centuries is any man may speak, no woman may speak. And the main problems have arisen not because the women spoke, but because far too many men spoke. And it's the men who spoke without having anything to say that did the damage down the years. And we blame it all on the beloved sisters. I actually have no special objection to a sister teaching. I could say the same of men. I have no particular objection to a man teaching, provided he is capable of doing it well. And the same goes for the sister. Now, is it to be expected that the sister cannot do it well? Now, I've always regarded my wife as one of the most gifted speakers for a woman. That I have ever heard. And I've dedicated the last 50-something years of married life, among other things, to giving her every opportunity possible, as it was in my power to do, to help her to have the opportunity to exercise her gift. Late last year, we were at church where there was a lady up front conducting the meeting. Boy, I had no problem with that because she was a marvellous musician, a trained singer, and she conducted it with poise and dignity, and she had no broidered hair or pearls or godly array, costly array that I could see, but she was an attractive appearance. I thought, marvellous. I'm not particularly one for responding to solemn leaders, but this particular one got the old vocal cords mobilised. It's a matter of ability to do it. Now the implication is that the men are more likely to be able to carry the authority and the ability to lead the church publicly than the women are. Am I being sexist? The same complaint is found in the newspapers all the time about the employment of women in high places in business. They're not given opportunity, and when they are given opportunity, they're not paid a tithe of what the men get. Implicitly, there is some sort of a difference. Now, I think Paul felt, maybe subconsciously, that the teaching might not be terribly popular. After all, he'd been to Philippi and the prayer meeting was in charge of a lady merchant named Lydia. And that didn't worry Paul. He went there and he didn't walk out when Lydia led in prayer. seen that, not for many years, prayer that I'd walk out when a woman leads in prayer in a meeting. I'm in danger of using expletives to describe how I feel, so I'd better say nothing. And yet, there are matters to be considered. And here they are, the last movement in the section. Why does Paul fret about this? Adam was first formed, then Eve. Now that's not the reason. That's a historical fact. Nowadays there's a lot of argument about creation. The Apostle Paul, in writing to Timothy, believed in the Garden of Eden. No monkey business, in other words. You can have your ancestors in the zoological gardens if you wish, but I will have mine in the Garden of Eden. And so it was with Paul. But what about the Neanderthals and Mary Leakey's discoveries in Tanganyika, and the notion that the Aboriginal culture is 40,000 years old? What about these things? I have no true answer to that. I'm not prepared to say that the scientists have got it wrong. Scientists are doing better all the time. But what I am prepared to say is this. Whether there were humanoids, hominids, human-like persons, before Adam and Eve, Paul believed that there was a Garden of Eden and an original couple, and if he believed it, I believe it too. That doesn't stop me reading the subject widely and trying to reconcile all the aspects of it, but whatever conclusions I come to, I cannot overthrow the literal nature of the early chapters of Genesis. But why invoke them? And Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived was in the transgression. Now that looks as if he's being nasty about Eve and saying she went wrong, not Adam. But actually Adam went wrong to a significantly greater extent than Eve did. The serpent was a very attractive entity, and he dealt very subtly with Eve. He didn't say, "Oh, I can't take any notice of that old gentleman with a big beard." He said, "Did God really, truly say that you couldn't eat the fruit? It's a test to see whether you are your own person or not." He thought it over and thought, certainly God would wish me to have the apple. And she had herself on and she took the apple and she ate it. And she called to Adam and said, "Adam, I've never tasted anything so nice." And she gave it to him. He took a deep breath and he shrugged and he ate it. Which was the bigger idiot? Eve said to Adam, "Don't eat it." Adam thought, "Well, God said that. What did I say?" Eve said to Adam, "Eat up." And Adam thought God said no, but he took it just the same because his wife said so. So he had the same problem. He was under the thumb. And his transgression was actually worse. But Paul is not trying to say that one or the other is inferior or superior. He is trying to say men and women are different. And the word that comes to mind in this matter is hallelujah. Not much response to that today. All right. They were in the transgression together, but Eve was deceived and sinned, and Adam was not deceived, but he still sinned. That's one reason why it makes it the more dangerous to put a brother in a place of influence who is not spiritually qualified to take that place. All right, the notes on the board say much the same as I've said. These things are in other parts of the Word of God. Fifth last line. Satan deceived Eve. John 8:44 says that Satan is a liar. That's his prime method of getting Christians to do the wrong thing. I learned this from Milton when I was at school. Paradise Lost, Book 2. When all the demons were in the business of rendering hell more tolerable, Milton wrote of Belial that his ability was to make the worse appear the better reason. In other words, persuading by specious and the expert persuader, of course, does it in terms of the desires of the person being persuaded. And people that have the ability to do this, well, they're the ones that the advertising agencies employ. They're the ones that write the successful commercials, making the worse appear the better reason. Notwithstanding, now he's going to say something palliative here. She shall be saved in childbearing. Now, whatever does that mean? Read the commentaries and you'll get umpteen explanations. The most pious one of all is that she is saved by the childbearing of Mary, by the incarnation, by the birth of Christ, his matchless life and his sacrificial reconciling death. But I don't think that's what Paul meant. It's certainly true. But in what sense is she saved by childbearing or in childbearing? The preposition is actually by means of childbearing. And the last sentence on the board there says what I think that means, and I'm afraid some might find it a little bit anti-feminist, but it's how I think Paul saw it. Believing, loving, godly, self-controlled women have their opportunities in the place of greatest usefulness, home, family, and children. That is not to say that is their only place, not for a moment. But it is the top priority place in the marketplace. Capable women are less acceptable to higher management because of the risk that at some critical time they'll declare themselves pregnant and want umpteen months maternity leave. And that is a normal, natural thing. But it is terribly inconvenient to those that lead in business. And it is probably the greatest deterrent to the hiring of women that in many cases are more capable than men in management, because at least they've got the human touch. Probably one of the greatest deterrents to higher management doing that is the possibility that the woman will give priority to that which her total instincts have been created by God to do, which is home, family, and children. But experience shows that these do not exclude the other. And it is possible to have home, family, and children on the one hand, and a marvelous ministry of God as well. And if you're fortunate, like I am, that you have a wife that is interested or has been in the past, subject to age, in home, family, and children, and at the same time anxious to serve God, then the word again is hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, it's an interesting passage, and